Just a moment. Window behind me. Anyway, let's see. Windows are not best.
No. Can it be closed? Listen to the clients.
Yes. Okay, that's good. It's a bit better, maybe. Yeah. Yeah, really good. Hare Krishna. Still adjust a little more. So we have been the last week in Switzerland, in the mountains, in a nice hotel, which is also like a mountain. And my room is on the top floor, and it's really like climbing a mountain. And then there is a nice view on even bigger mountains with snow caps and everything. In very nice association with Sachinanand Swami and with Badahari. So lots of nice kirtan, lots of nice katha. And it is just so valuable to be with devotees and to be able to spend some time, just some time, simply discussing something about Krishna. It is said, Su Su Sho Shavadana Shavasu Diva Katari Chi Syam Mahat Sevya Vipra Punyatirtan Vesiyat, that if we are by serving the Vaishnavas, we become attached to hearing the messages about Vasudeva, Krishna. So this is what we do. We rotate these things. Sometimes we serve the devotees. I try, you know, it's not always easy to serve devotees. Sometimes, to be honest, it gets on my nerves. All these devotees, there's so many of them. And they're like, okay, can I ask you one question? Yes. Can I ask you another question? Yes. Yeah, it's like sometimes I feel like, but then again, I try to remember. I try to remember that devotees are valuable, and each person is valuable, and that. So, if we can somehow or other serve the Vaishnavas in some way or other, then it. Everything gets blessed. Like here, the prasadam has been really good. I mean, devotees really put a lot of effort, right? They made all kinds of fancy stuff. For me, they also made lots of fancy stuff, which is appreciated, even to a point where now I want something super simple to balance out the taste of prasadam. But the bhakti that we saw in all the arrangements is really, I think all of us felt that here, and that has made this retreat something very nice. And then as a bonus, we had some mountains and some nice little walks and some fresh clean air and a real mountain water to drink and stuff like that, you know. That was nice. I also met Danista's friend Amrita Bani from Mexico. Yes, so that was also very nice. Like that, I have, been a nice week, and in general, this time somehow or other, there's some opportunity to us. opportunities arise, we should take advantage. We should just take advantage of such an opportunity, because that doesn't, it's not always possible. And, you know, different things may take us away from the devotees. Work may it's like some devotees from Berlin, and they thank you. So here the internet is a little unstable. It keeps on dropping, you know. So I've been on a few other Zooms and I got thrown out on a few occasions. So please tolerate that. Each time though, I was able to get back in. So that's what we're doing. I was just telling about this couple from Berlin who came last minute and somehow borrowed a van and are staying in the van. And that's the spirit, you know. Stay in the van, stay in the car, stay in a tent, somehow or other. When the opportunity arises to associate with devotees, take it. Just take it. It is very valuable. We were recently in Holland, of course, in a retreat organized by Mariska and Astasaki, and it was also lots of fun. There was no mountains there. It was pretty flat, to say the least, but it was also very nice. Just staying in the forest and being with devotees. So even our Zoom is precious because we are with devotees. I'm here looking at the devotees, and I'm seeing that Ananta is on the Zoom and playing table tennis at the same time. It's very, that's very interesting, you know. It's amazing. They call it multitasking. They're very efficient. I used to do something like that when I was a kid, because we had to learn topography, and for some reason I had to learn the map of Russia, and I thought, why? At the time I couldn't really see the point of learning the map of Russia. I go, topography, it's a big country and all these places. And then there was one place in particular, Dniepropetrovsk, right? Which for a Dutchman is almost impossible to pronounce. I mean, my nose wrinkles when I say it, Dniepropetrovsk. And it was too much, you know. So, and I was sitting there trying to learn this, and I was thinking about playing darts, you know. In those days, I used to throw darts. And so I decided, I went in the attic at the top of the house, and on the wooden wall with chalk, I drew a big map of Russia and all the places on there. And then with the darts, I was trying to hit the targets. So then I had to list, okay, Dniepropetrovsk, throw the darts, you know. That's how I learned the topography of Russia. It worked, you know. So whatever it takes, you know. If it takes table tennis, then it's table tennis. Yena tena prakarena mana krishna. Whatever it takes, says Rupa Goswami. to fix the mind on Krishna. And that's what we desire, to somehow fix the mind of Krishna. So many complicated things in the material world. I try not to take the material world too serious. It's been a long time since I realized that that you cannot fix the material world, and there's always something. And I just try not to to make too much of it in my mind, you know. It is what it is. Sometimes I like it, sometimes I don't. But it is what it is, and I try to just turn to Krishna. Always turn to Krishna again. That is the thing. Keep on turning to Krishna. And this we have to practice, you know, to just turn towards Krishna. And, today I ended a 3-day seminar. And it's going to be about some weeks, which is really such a nice book. I wouldn't even say it's nice, you know. I tried to give the devotees a taste for the Brihat Bhagavatamrita and to enthuse them to start reading it, you know, or buy it even, you know, if they don't have it yet. Because it's something you can read in the fast lane, you know. It's not like one of those books that are like extremely difficult to get through, you know. It's like it's sort of easy reading and it's sweet reading. So it's a story after all, it's a novel. It's not just a just philosophy. And this Brihat Bhagavatamrita, I told a little bit of the background, you know. I told them something about Gopiparanadhana, and I think I'll just share that with you also. Gopiparanadhana Prabhu was a great scholar in ISKCON. And he was at the same time a very humble personality, very brahminical. And he was, I met him for the first time in India in 1978. And he came to India. And at the time, I was the manager of the restaurant in Vrindavan. And he was one of our daily customers. So I spoke to him a bit in those days, and he was working on a project in Vrindavan. In Vrindavan, you have the Vrindavan Research Institute, and the Vrindavan Research Institute is a government institute where they are collecting manuscripts. You see, traditionally, the manuscripts are kept in temples. So, but you know, now, before they all get lost, the government sort of made an arrangement to sponsor an academic group in making a depository of manuscripts. So many original manuscripts, Goswami literature is there, and all kinds of things, all kinds of books, in, of course, in Sanskrit and Bengali. And Gopiparanadhana, he was making microfilms of them, so that there would be a digital, a digital record. Microfilm is a good format, you know, which stays, right? Because we always have the changing digital formats, and the old stuff doesn't work anymore. But okay, so they made an archive. So he's working on that. But later, he worked on translating and did some work on the Sandarbhas, and then did the Brihat Bhagavatamrita. Now, the Brihat Bhagavatamrita is a work of Sanatana Goswami. It's his principal book. And what happened then was the Brihat Bhagavatamrita, Sanatana Goswami, wrote the book in Sanskrit. And what Gopiparanadhana did, he first studied the way that Sanatana Goswami used the Sanskrit words. So he spent quite some time studying it like that. And then he had a good feel for how Sanatana Goswami used the Sanskrit words. Only then did he start translating. So it's very thorough, really thorough. Well, he's a kapha personality. He was very thorough. They're extremely slow and thorough. Really slow and really thorough. But so this, and then some very good editing was done by Kesh Babarti Maharaj and by Jayadrata Maharaj. And in this way, the Brihad Bhagavatamrita is pakka. It's a very important book. And so at the end of the book, there's a few stories in the book. One story is the story of Gopakumar. And Gopakumar goes back to Godhead. And we were just reading it, he was in Vrindavan and he just somehow or other was overwhelmed by ecstasy, fell into the Yamuna, and next moment he's sort of very fast flying to the spiritual world, and he arrives there in this kingdom, and then he meets up with Krishna. And it's not just a quick meeting, it's like a really heartfelt meeting. And Krishna is very happy to see that Gopakumar is back. So this is so nice, because here, Sanatana Goswami is not just telling us a story about Gopakumar, but he's basically telling us how personal it is, and how much Krishna cares, right? And how much he cares about every individual living being, and how there's a real loving relationship. And Sanatana Goswami really goes in there very deeply, and that Krishna is, Gopakumar is elated to see Krishna. And when Gopakumar sees Krishna from close up, he just faints. But then he comes back to his senses. But then Krishna faints, and Krishna is not even coming to his senses, lying on the ground, and he's just shedding tears, and it's just incredible. And Gopakumar is just looking incredulously, did I cause that kind of thing? Right? And is that because of me? Right? And it is. That's because of him. So the depth of Krishna's feeling for his devotees is really highlighted. And then I kind of spoke how, for me, this is not just something. The story begins where Krishna returns from the forest. Somehow or other, that has become for me a meditation, because I started spiritual at the prophet's house, and there was the painting. There are different paintings. There's the painting above Prabhupada's Vyasa Sam. There's a painting of Radha Govinda sitting on a throne, and eight gopis are fanning them. And then they're sitting under a desire tree, and there are jewels under the roots of the desire tree. That's from a verse in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, that painting. And then on the other side of Prabhupada's bed, there is a painting of Krishna and Balaram with all the cows and cowherd boys coming back in the evening. And then all the gopis and the elders are all looking and ready to receive them in their own ways, and the animals and everybody is extended. It's just, it was not, I liked it, I had to stand somewhere and chant japa. I was too tired to sit down. So I would just stand in front of the painting and even sort of walk a bit forward and backward, but all the time looking at the painting and chanting. That was my early japa chanting in Vrindavan. And that really, that painting became more than a painting to me. That became a meditation. And I saw in that painting, I saw all the rasas. I saw all the different, all of Vrindavan is really in that painting. And so that painting is just engraved into my consciousness as like there's an impression, there is a sanskar, there is a deep impression, and it's a vision of Krishna, and I meditate on that. The painting became a meditation, and I spoke a bit about that, and I've dealt with that in my novel also, with that painting, and I gave some examples which I took from there. But it is really, really very, very, it is like that spiritual life. So my point today to the devotees was that we're not just reading stories, we're not just looking at paintings, but they become a meditation. Some points just become a meditation. I see Gopakumara there in the spiritual world, returning back to Godhead, and that became a meditation. And that's why I wanted to speak about it to the devotees here, and why I summarized it now to you, just so that you can share a little bit with this point that sometimes we encounter things in the books that really impress us deeply, and they become part of our meditation. That can be different things. It can be a picture, like I have before, some time ago, spoken about the Brijbasi posters and about Murali Manohar last week. Yes, and actually what I didn't tell you then is that Murali Manohar form, the old one on the old Brijbasi posters, that also is my meditation, because there Krishna, he is very beautiful and very innocent at the same time. And I really like that. That's purity. Now there are some more modern paintings done, and there Krishna looks like a dude, you know. He sits there like a real cool guy. That's not Krishna. Krishna is innocent. And that carries that. Yes, that's why I love that old Brijbasi Murali Manohar. Burijan used it on his book, Unveiling His Lotus Feet, a study guide of Bhagavatam, for the cover. So you can Google it now, you know, Unveiling His Lotus Feet. If you want to unveil the lotus feet, Burijan does, you know, and then, yeah, you can, and then we can actually see the that picture of Murali Manohar. Yeah, so it may be a picture, it may be, or it may be a devotee. We were fortunate here to have Badahari, who is so such a sweet person, and who is chanting so with so much taste and so much devotion, that and starts slow and can pick up quite some pace. You know? I mean, you know. Pretty good pace. And that comes from KK Swami. Yeah. Takes one to know one. So yes, so there were some really nice kirtans. He said yesterday the ceiling was coming down and everything was flapping while he was going for it. Anyway, he was here, Sachinanda Maharaj here. So a lot of very sweet things. So just the association of these devotees is not only giving us a nice kirtan, is not only giving us a nice lecture, but it also shows how far it can go. They show us themselves. Right? We're not only seeing or hearing the kirtan, it's like beautiful melody, but they also show themselves and they show their Krishna consciousness. And by seeing their Krishna consciousness, we begin to kind of get an idea of where we could go in our Krishna consciousness also. Right? So they open up like, you know, an insight in how far it can go. In this way, many devotees, they show us how far Krishna consciousness can go. And this is not only happening to us now, but this is described in our books. For example, in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, Chaitanya Bhagavata, it is described how Madhavendra Puri is an incredible devotee. And that practically speaking, there was no devotee like Madhavendra Puri. Madhavendra Puri had traveled around the world, but he had never, ever seen so much love in anyone. He never met anyone who had as much love for Krishna as he met. But wherever he went, he touched people by his transcendental love and inspired them and so on. So Madhavendra Puri had disciples, and amongst them Iswara Puri. So at the same time, Nityananda was also on the planet. Nityananda is about 15 years older than Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Therefore, Nityananda counts as one of the elders. Like the previous generation who were there before Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, such as Madhavendra Puri is the previous generation, his disciples, previous generation. So then, somehow or other, the meeting between these two personalities is described, and it's just something out of this world. They both recognize and they see the love of God that the other one has, and it just makes them ecstatic beyond what you can imagine. And they embrace, and in that embrace, they crash to the ground and roll on the ground. And the disciples are just looking in amazement at how far ecstasy and Krishna consciousness can go. This is what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu showed. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu jumped in Ratha Yatra and he jumped so high, and everyone was just looking like, how can anyone jump so high? Right? And then down and up and down and just on and on, not once, you know.
Well, you know, he actually happens to be an Olympic jumper, right?
No, not like that, you know. He just keeps on jumping. He just bounces up, flies up. He throws his body up in the air. When Lord Chaitanya is dancing, he throws himself into the air. And he just comes back down. And then he again throws himself in the air. In this way, he jumps higher than anyone else. These are all the miracles, you know, the miracles of love of God. And so this is amazing, the miracles of love of God. When we look at the Chaitanya Charitamrita, Lord Chaitanya is described by Krishnadas as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And and as soon as he takes his birth as a child, even before there are miracles and after there are miracles, there's the child. There's a child running through the house. They hear the footsteps, you know, a running child, just barefoot, boom, 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 running. And ankle belts also, you know. But who's running? Not Nimai, because he's a baby. Babies don't run. But there are footprints in the house, and the footprints show the prince of the Lord, you know, the marks of the Lord. And they see these marks on the lotus feet of baby Nimai. But it can't be baby Nimai that's running because he's a baby, he can't run. Therefore, Jagannath Mishra has figured it out. He's figured it out. It must be the Shaligram Shiva. It's obvious. They always run around, you know? That's what they do. Shaligram Shiva. So it's just such amazing. So the miracles are happening, right? And there are many miracles happening in the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya. Later on, you know, there's Jalikanda, and all the tigers and the deers are embracing, elephants start dancing, and it's, I guess instead of blowing conch shells, they blow their, they have a natural horn, you know. It's quite an ecstatic kirtan there. You know, the tiger chanting, the jeep, and so on. One can just imagine what it was like. Absolutely miraculous. Yes. So the miracles are there in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, many. But the real miracle is not that miracle. The real miracle is the miracle of love of God. That's like, how can he cry so many tears? Where's all this water coming from? How can it be? There is a drain in the temple in Jagannath Puri, and there's a stream running down the drain. How is it possible? How can anybody cry that much? You know some people that cry that much. These are the miracles of love of God. So this is wonderful. And we see such miracles also. We see miracles in the devotees around us. We're seeing advanced devotees. And it's wonderful to see their Krishna consciousness. I was talking with Badahari, and we spoke a bit about Gopiparanadhana prabhu, because I had mentioned him earlier and some things about him. And then I also discussed a little bit, how I had told the story, how there was a meeting with Gopiparanadhana and Sridhar Maharaj. And Sridhar Maharaj had a bad liver at that time. And then we had a Bhagavad Katha there. And then Gopiparanadhana was reading and speaking from the commentaries. And it was amazing. It was amazing what he, all the details that he mentioned about the verses, and we were ecstatic about it. It was really nice. So Sridhar Maharaj also said, Gopi, you really used your life very, very well. I met Gopi the day before he died and reminded him of that time. And then Gopi went to Vrindavan and he left his body in Vrindavan. He used his life very well. And Krishna said, yes, you come back to Godhead. Krishna recognized him. Yes. Anyway, that was about Gopi. Meanwhile, I spoke with Badahari and told him something about Sridhar Maharaj. Sridhar Maharaj was also really something, such a transcendental personality. Sridhar Maharaj used to be a wrestler before Krishna consciousness. Right? So he was sort of a tough dude, you know? I mean, not like your lightweight. And as often happens with wrestlers, when they get out of practice, they gain weight, you know. So, and wrestlers like to eat usually also. Sridhar Maharaj used to pack it in, you know, so he got like quite a belly. And one time he looked at Jayavrajan Maharaj and said, why is it that these skinny guys are so advanced? Anyway, so I was in Vrindavan, and I am in the guest house in Vrindavan. I was the president of Vrindavan at the time, and it was a big temple and a lot of responsibility. So I was a busy man, that was for sure, very busy. So I'm going into the guest house for some business, and I'm walking through the narrow corridors and Sridhar Maharaj comes from the other side. So I'm seeing him and I'm saying, Hari Bol Maharaj. Right? He steps right in front of me, pulls his belly back and then swings it forward and hits me with the thing. And I tell you, it was rock solid. It wasn't soft, it was hard as a rock. And the weight, yeah, I flew, next moment I flew against the wall and he pinned me with his belly against the wall. And he says, karma kanda, jnana kanda, kevala visirabanda. Now, okay, I am familiar with Narottama's Thakur and I know that Narottama's Thakur said that karma kanda, the ritualistic activities which give material benefit, or the endeavors of jnana kanda, the endeavors for liberation, are simply pots of poison, right? So the endeavors for impersonal liberation. So I was pinned against the wall and he had just recited that and I started thinking. And then I thought, oh, he's telling me, don't be so impersonal. So then I said, how are you, Maharaj? Then he let me go from the wall and gave me a lecture and said, you know, whenever you meet a sadhu, right, you must take time. You must take time to take some association with the sadhu. You should never just walk past the sadhu. Yes, Maharaj, of course, Maharaj. Now I appreciate, because now management, yeah, whatever I had to do that day, I can't, it was very important, but I can't remember what it was. I can't remember. Sridhar Maharaj, right? And what he told me, what he gave me. Yes. So, speaking about that with Padahari also yesterday. And then, yeah, it was, now that I'm talking about Sridhar Maharaj. And so one time, we're going to Rath Yatra in a car. Maharaj is sitting in the front and two of us in the back, I think. Burijan, I think Burijan was in the back, and I was also in the back. And then, so Sridhar Maharaj turns around and he says, Now tell me, now that you are a guru, right, do you think you are equal to us? I said, no. I've already been pinned against the wall once, you know, so I was careful. I said, no, of course not, Maharaj. I am just your humble servant, right? And he said, ah, yes, very good. So, okay. We're driving to Delhi and we're going to Rath Yatra. So we're coming to the Rath Yatra area, the street from where the chariots are supposed to be. And there's a barrier, you know, in India, they have these barriers on wheels, you know, which they sort of wheel onto the road, metal barriers. And they have two of those blocking the road. And there's a cop. He's got a gun and everything. He stands guarding it, you know what I mean? So we drive up to the barrier. And I was ready, since I was the servant, right? I was ready to fix it. And Sridhar Maharaj said, no, I'll do that, you know what I mean? He gets out of the car. Then he goes up to one of the barriers and he grabs it and he just goes, takes the other one, throws that at the cop is looking at, like, what is this? You know, the big orange sadhu throws the barriers aside. What's it supposed to do? Then Maharaj, in his sweetest, with his sweetest smile, Hare Krishna. Gets back in the car, and we drive to. Then we get to the chariot, you know. We get to the chariot. And, okay, the Swamis are supposed to get on the chariot. And Sridhar Maharaj, he gave his only Hindi lecture that he knew, you know. He knew one Hindi lecture, but it was a good one. And he's telling the people how the government is stealing them blind, and he's telling them, okay. And he talks about Krishna, this, that, devotional service, and he's got everyone engaged, you know, the whole crowd, they're laughing, they're totally with it, you know. He brings them in, and they're totally, totally like part of his lecture. You know, and then Maharaj comes down, and he's going to lead a kirtan. And he was leading kirtan, you know, with a really high voice. So he had a nasal voice, a super nasal voice.
Krishna Krishna
Okay, he did that. Namaste. He did Sri Krishna Chaitanya and one round of Hare Krishna, and that was it. You know? And then he left, you know. Then he went and, you know, he left, and that was it. He'd been a Drati Archer. It was short, you know, and he drove all the way to Delhi for that. And well, he had to also catch something, some transport from Delhi. But he was there really short, only at the beginning, but he was there. He was really. Yeah, that was something. Our Sridhar Maharaj. Yeah. I have somehow or other. I took sannyas in 1997. Now, I had been shot in 1995, so in 1997, I was still very weak, still recovering, you know, I was really like, okay. So we're at the Rati Yatra in New York, and Sridhar Maharaj is there, and he's sort of, at the end of the Rati Yatra, he jumps on the mic, and he became a transcendental terror. He was just there, and he starts yelling at everyone, you know, and telling them, we have to take down these tents and nobody can leave this square. You can't, you with the blue t-shirt, you cannot go. You help to break down these tents. Nothing like this. He would watch the whole square and no one would get away. I tell you, men and women, everybody had to dismantle this thing. And then I was standing there with my Dhamma. And then I was still standing there and not taking down the tents. So he goes, Kadamba Kanana Swami. He said, do you think that now you've got a danda that you don't have to do anything? Over the loudspeaker, you know, totally embarrassing me in public. And I just didn't care, you know. I didn't care at all. I just totally ignored him. right? And didn't do it, you know. Anyway, so later I met him in the temple, you know. And then he goes like, yeah, like, I mean, you just stood there. You know. I said, like, well, Maharaj, you know. I said, like, it's not long ago that I got shot, right? And said, there's no way that I'm going to do physical work right now in this condition, Maharaj. And that's it. Right? You know, I mean, my Dutchness, you know, came out. Right? I gave it to him straight. And then he says, yeah, well, you could have at least encourage the devotees. I said, Maharaj, you were already doing it. And that's what you're doing. Great job. I really didn't think you needed any help at it, you know. You had it covered, you know. Oh my God, Sri Maharaj. Yeah, it's such a. But such a dear person, dear Swami. And there he was, you know. He wanted to see the installation of Panchatattva. And he was on the altar and bathing the deities. And 1 week later, and then the next day, he was sick again, totally. Lying there, liver failing in his final days. Someone or Krishna let him do that abhishek. And then, yeah, in the Jumna Maharaj came to say goodbye. And Sridhar Maharaj was in the shower. And in the Jumna Maharaj is knocking on the door. Maharaj, open up. I gotta say goodbye, and this is my last chance, and I gotta go, I gotta get a flight, get out of that bathroom. Hurry up, get out of the bathroom, come on. And so then at one point, the bathroom door opened, and Maharaj said, come in. You know, he was in his Adam's. And he broke anyway. So they had their last farewell. in the shower. In the bathroom. Such an amazing person. It takes all kinds, you know. His belly was swelling up at the end, so just, and then he was lying there on his back, and the senior devotees were in the room. Someone touched it. Maharaj opened his eyes and said, it's a boy. Some years earlier, I came to Mayapur to the festival. And I didn't have a place reserved. You know? So they told me, you can stay with Sridhar Maharaj. You know, sannyasa to the sannyasa. So they sent me to Sridhar Maharaj. I come to the room and he's very sweet. He says, oh, they told you to stay with me. How nice. I'd be so happy to have your association. Yes, it's very nice. You can stay here. You're the fourth sannyasi who comes to stay here. He said, Sachinandan Swami was also here, but he left. So, you know, oh God. So I go, sort of, what happened? and then he says, I snore. Now, you know, I got a little worried, right? So it was about 6 o'clock, so I thought I could still score some earplugs, you know. So I went somewhere to score some earplugs. So I put in the earplugs and he was snoring. I mean, so loud, you know. I mean, incredibly loud. I tell you, it was hot, so all we had was a bed sheet. Each time he just snored, the bed sheet started. Incredible. It was so bad that I had the earplugs and I also wrapped a gamsha around my head, you know, around my ears, so that I just somehow or other get some sleep. I had a terrible night, but then the next day he was so sweet that I tolerated it, you know. I stayed there for 3 nights. And somehow or other, through the snoring, hardly slept. But anyway, had this sweet association throughout the day. Even his servants knew all about it, you know. And they would, at the night, sort of, there's Adbutahari, you know, I mean, his servant from Croatia. And he would just sort of give me this smile from. It was terrible. But so transcendental. So in his final days, Sridhar Maharaj, he was just, he told his servant, He told his servant, today I'm going to leave. Oh no, there was one more thing I should tell. He met Brajabihari and he said to Brajabihari, he said, I've been a good boy. He said, I followed the standards. And just see, you know, been a good boy, followed the standards, he served. And see how much mercy. And then he's on the last day, he announced, today I'm going to leave my body. And his servant said, Maharaj, don't be so negative. You never know. And Maharaj said, no, I'm going to leave today. Very casual, like I'm going to the shop today. No, I'm good. And then later that day, he left his body. And he was totally fearless. Some years before, I visited him, and he was worshiping this intense Nisringa Shila, you know, the one with the super big mouth and all the teeth and everything. I said, Maharaj, why are you worshiping this deity? Thinking, well, it could be something sweeter. And then, so that I can become free from fear. He was totally free from fear at the end, totally. For him, leaving the body was just like going to a shop, you know, just like nothing, didn't face him out at all. Totally like casual about it. Not acting, but really just, I'm giving the body to you, giving up my body to you. Nothing dramatic about it. Totally casual. Wow. What a Vaishnava. What an association. What mercy. I saw this amazing Vaishnava. He told me he went to India to meet Prabhupada and then decided to stay in India and thought, I may as well stay a brahmachari this life. And he did that. And he'd been a good boy. How nice. Just such nice Vaishnavas in this movement. Amazing. So yes, and each of them show us, right, show us what Krishna consciousness can be, you know what I mean? And what we can become, and that is so wonderful, so wonderful. Yeah. So many wonderful Vaishnavas. And different Vaishnavas are empowered in different ways. And just Prithu Babu, who is my old friend. He's such a preacher, such a desire to make devotees, right? And that's how he makes devotees, by this desire. Yes, he's watching. You know, he's watching for opportunities. And if he sees one, you know, he looks at and he focuses on one person. You know, and he just goes, there's a crowd, but he sees one and he just goes for that one person and he just like works him over and sort of, you know, whatever he wants. If someone says he wants to travel, then Prithu has a travel program. If someone wants to play piano, then Prithu has a band. You know, he has it all, you know. And somehow or other, they're in. And next moment, you know, they're in Prithu's barber shop, right? And before they know it, they're scalped, you know. it's such a desire. And to see that desire, right? One can also develop a bit of a desire to make a devotee. You know? He just made devotees, and that's what he did. And, so we can get so many inspirations from the Vaishnavas. And mind you, the Vaishnavas come in all kinds of, in all sizes, in all moods, and all all different types. You know, it's not that it automatically means there's one type of devotee, and the kind of humble, meditative, Vaishnava says, oh yeah, he's very advanced, yeah. He's very humble. He said, no, also the wild ones, the you know, I mean, we had this devotee named Yogesh Candra, disciple of Srila Prabhupada. Yogesh Candra was a Sankirtan devotee. And he was like empowered. He could make anyone do more than double. You know, whatever they could do, he could make them do more than double. And he did it. He proved it every time again. Wherever he went, the Sankirtan devotees started to do double. And but he was behind them, you know, and with support and with preaching. And Yogesh Candra, you know, I met him first in 1979, when for a short while I was in Europe. And here's this big American, also quite big body, with a big blue jacket, looking like Mr. Michelin, with blue jeans, and he comes in, and we, the Sankirtan devotees, had come for a meeting, and we were all supposed to sit there in devotional clothes. So we were sitting in devotional clothes. He comes in his blue jeans and his jacket. He says to a brahmachari, "Give me that chata." He took the saffron chata, sat down, threw it over his lap like a Sankirtan devotee, and said, "Man, we've got to take over the world." And he pushed the Sankirtan and doubled the Sankirtan. I was only there as a guest for a short while on a break from India, so I was going back to India. Years later, Yogi, as we call him, settled in Vrindavan, and I was president of Vrindavan. He walks into my office and said, "I want you to make me the Sankirtan leader." Okay. "I want you to make me the Sankirtan leader." So I made him the Sankirtan leader on the spot. And sure enough, you know, all the book distribution scores doubled. Everybody, in no time, you know, he had them hopping. And he gave Sankirtan classes, right? He gave Sankirtan classes, and he goes like, yeah. You know, he said, you know, every man in this temple, he's talking now like man, you know, said every man in this temple should go out on book distribution. Right? And if you don't go out, you're not a man. Then Ayendra is there, you know. So Ayendra, not in the lecture, but after the lecture, made a comment. And the comment was, "Well, some of us don't mind to be women, you know." So Yogi heard all about it, you know. And Yogi heard, "This is outrageous. You know? he's sabotaging the Sankirtan movement." So like a general, he marched on Ayendra's room, you know, and he bang, 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 bang. So Ayendra opens the door, and there's this big guy. He's all like worked up. So, and he says, "Listen, Ayendra, listen, I'm a gopi too." That and then then he says also, "And I'm a left-wing gopi." And the angel says, "I'm a right-wing gopi." Oh my God. It's a transcendental circus sometimes. It's like all these personalities, right? All these personalities in this movement, incredible personalities, so different, you know, such different moods, but also dedicated, and you know, all giving everything they have. And it's just, it's a wonderful world. It really is, to see their devotion, to see the sacrifice they make, besides the funny stories, right? But to see that these devotees, they really make a huge endeavor. It's not nothing to make the sankirtan devotees do double. It doesn't just happen by saying, do double. You gotta organize sankirtan. You're gonna make sure they got the right books at the right place, the right prasadam, the right transport, that they're out at the right spot at the right time. You know, you got to make sure they are in good spirits, that there is a good sadhana behind it, that there is, you have to babysit them, you have to drive them, you have to inspire them, you have to give them the best prasadam, you have to. Then sankirtan devotees start to fly, and then the books fly out, and suddenly it starts to happen. And that was Yogesh Candra. So yes, this is what we, this is how this movement became great. And this has to repeat itself. This has to happen now also. It's not just, on the sankirtan course for yesterday were Bhakta Bonzo, 11 books, and Bhakti and Susi, one maha big and three small. It's like, no, we want more. It's nice. We appreciate a small service. One book is valuable. Absolutely. But still, we want more. I always remember Tamal Krishnamaraj, after his disappearance, there was a Chinese lady. And this Chinese lady, she spoke. And she was just saying that she used to do like 40 books a day, which is a serious number, right? That's a good number. Tamal Krishnamaraj told her he wanted 100. She said, 100? I can't do 100. I can't do it. But he would never back down. He said, I want it. Yeah. He pushed her. And she just was stubbornly saying, no, no, no. I can't do it. I can't do it. And she just resisted and resisted and resisted. And he would not back down. He wanted 100. And then she never did 100. Only just before he left, somehow or other, one day, she did 100. Yeah, it happened. And then a few days later, he left. And she was just crying and crying, you know, like, about 100, and just how he drove her, and how he drove her. I mean, this, but this is it's not cheap, right? I mean, we don't get Krishna consciousness, we don't get the mercy of the Lord just so cheaply. Some effort has to be made, something has to be done. So yeah, all these things are imprinted on my memory. I can never forget this. Maharaj drove his disciple, but it made an impression on me, something I will not forget. And so somewhere over today, I'm in the mood of remembering the things I never forget. Yeah. And just, this talk is about the things I'll never forget. You thought it was a talk of funny stories, but they may be funny, but behind it was a very serious Krishna consciousness and a tremendous commitment. And that's why I'll never forget these stories. Besides their funniness, but, I'll never forget. serious commitment. And all that is inspiring me, nourishing me, and reminding me. All these memories remind me. Now you also make some serious endeavor. Don't hold back. Give it your best. If you really want something, wouldn't you give it your best? If you really want it, you can have it, but today there is one ticket, and the one who really shows us something special will get it. Okay, I want it. I want that ticket, and now I'm really going to do something. That spirit of giving it our best. I think that's maybe the theme of the day, and that is my more serious message. Not that we should over-endeavor. I'm not talking right. It's like I once almost fell out of the window after a near-jal ekadasi, and I realized that maybe I'm not the ideal person for near-jal ekadasi. I got dizzy, and I was just there was a relatively low window, and I was like heading for it, and whoa. So, yeah, whatever we can do within our boundaries and limits, not that we are over-endeavoring, but endeavor is that is there. And rewards will be there because Krishna will recognize. Eyatamam prapadyate tamasthataya vijayam. He will reciprocate. So I thank him for being with us and hearing all these stories about the Vaishnavas. I have, of course, many more about many other Vaishnavas. Would really love to share them with you. I have more funny stories. I remember that Bibi Govinda Swami, before he took sannyas, he was trying to lose weight because, you know, he's a bit overweight at the time. And then he went on a carrot juice fast. And the fast was, you could drink as much carrot juice as you wanted, but only carrot juice and nothing but carrot juice. Right? That's what he's doing. And you know, he lost weight, he did. But you know what also happened? He turned orange. Yeah, he's getting into some, he's preparing for sannyas. Yeah. So, but it's not easy, huh? And he did that for a long time, for maybe 2 months or something, just carrot juice. Only carrot juice for 2 months. It's like, no wonder he turned on. But yeah, that was interesting. I see. Arjun Raja says, we will do that preparation for the next King's Day. Very good. That would be nice. Yes. I always make jokes with Arjun Raja. That's our relationship. Been a long time, Arjun, since we exchanged jokes. We should somehow or other catch up again. Anyway, devotees, I have maybe entertained you a little bit, I hope. But as I said again, I'm looking at the service attitude of all these Vaishnavas, and that is what impresses me. Because I know that is what impresses Krishna. Yeah, that's wonderful. So let's all think of something something we can do, whatever it is. Yeah? I don't do the near jobs. I leave that to someone else. You know, but I do, I drink water. But I'll do other things. Yeah. Count on me for some other service. Yeah. So all together, let's do something. That would be one. Well, I thank you very much. And now I'd like to hear from you for 15 more minutes. Then here we have a Bhakti Charu Maharaj Memorial Program. Yes, because it's now the 1 year anniversary of Maharaj's departure. And of course, he was also a wonderful, wonderful Vaishnava. Okay, yes, Gopali.
Hare Krishna, dear Guru Maharaj. I would like to ask, you were talking about Brihad Bhagavatamrita and the purpose there. You were talking about Brihad Bhagavatamrita. The purpose there, they are written by Sanatan Goswami or Gopiparanadhana Prabhu, or should we read also the purpose, or how is that?
Okay. So there, Sanatana Goswami wrote notes. He wrote a commentary in note form. And then what happened is that Gopi assembled these notes and put them in an organized manner and in some sort of sentences. And then Kesava Bharati and Jayadvaita Swami turned it into English in proper sentences. Yeah? So therefore the purports read very nicely in English, but they are basically the purports of Sanatana Goswami. So yes, these purports are completely Sanatana Goswami and very rich, very rich. Yeah. Thank you very much. Okay, some people are in the chat, but I have some difficulty because I'm working from an iPad and then it's really hard to read the chat.
Can so I also ask, like, if it's a fiction, Brihad Bhagavatamrita, or is it a real story?
Yeah, that's sort of, in the beginning, it is said that Maharaj Pariksit told it to his mother, right? So is it a real story or a fiction? We think it's a fiction, but others think it's a vision, yeah? It's a vision of Sanatana Goswami. Sometimes it's a vision and sometimes it's a fiction. So Gopakumar may be a fictionary or a personality, you know, but of course, the descriptions about the universe where Gopakumar goes through in the spiritual world, there Sanatana Goswami has a vision. You know, we discussed this week how at one point Gopakumar goes to the layers of the universe, and then he goes to the earth, and there Bhumi worships Varaha, and next layer Varuna worships in the water, Varuna worships Matsya. Finally, he comes to the layer of the illusory energy of Maya, and there is Maya, and her domain is like effulgent, blackish, bluish, like Krishna, very attractive. And then Maya is worshipping Mohini Murti. Yeah. So in this way, it's very interesting, Brihad Bhagavatamrita, because lots of interesting details. And those, of course, are coming from scripture and sometimes right there from the vision of Sanatana Goswami, who can see what we cannot, and therefore opens our eyes. our darkened eyes with transcendental knowledge. Okay, a few more questions and then I can't see anything but myself now because the host has just highlighted me. So I'm looking at Kadamba Kanana's body. At least I shaved this morning, so that helps. My tilak is still there. That's good. My glasses are a little smudged. I can straighten out my thing. But how long can I look in the mirror? So do I really have to do this? Okay, yeah. I'm looking now at all of you. Oh, here is Bhaktin Oa. Happy to see you. Are you well?
Yeah, I'm well, Maharaj. I've been in South Africa now for the last 3 months.
Yeah.
Home. It's been very difficult. It's cold. But we made it to South Africa, my daughter and I. But I'm experiencing.
Adapting? Sorry. Your daughter?
Yeah,
she likes it, South Africa?
Yeah, she speaks three languages now, Spanish, English, and Setswana.
Wow, cool.
And she's playing with the kids, the local kids, very nicely here in Soweto. And she's loving it. She's having a time of her life.
Nice.
I've started the foundation. My education foundation is going very well. It's nice. Registered. I am teaching yoga to kids every morning.
Great.
At a local daycare center. But Maharaj, I've received some negative welcoming from some people. Some family members have been quite cold. And while I was gone for 5 years in Mexico, my grandmother passed away. And so some people feel that the first thing I should have done is to go and visit the grave.
I see.
I'm a bit confused.
Yeah, I mean, you can say, that my grandmother is not in her grave. She's in my heart, right? She's always with me. And she's been with me all these 5 years that I was absent. And so on. And I think, there will be always some people that will say such a thing, that try to impose some social duty upon us, right? And some neglect and this. And I think, to me, what matters most is that she's in my heart. Yeah? That's where she really is, in the heart. Yeah, what to do, bro?
Yeah, we're chapatis being fried on.
Yeah. In Mexico, it was a tortilla,
In Mexico, it was tortilla.
Yeah, what to do, huh? But yeah. I think it was interesting that you were in Mexico for 5 years, because it gives a whole different experience, of the world. You've seen something of the world, right? And it's like now you're back in Soweto, but, there are people who've never left Soweto. They don't know what you know. They haven't seen what you've seen. So this is really, really enriching, actually. And then as a devotee, all of you see also what it's like there, that there are devotees there. Yeah. Must have been very interesting.
Very interesting.
Yeah, I used to meet you in Soweto, then it took a while before I realized you were in Mexico, and then it's like, oh, Then I found out you're in Mexico, and I was like, wow, Mexico. Here's the it's like real surprise. Someone from Soweto in Mexico. I wasn't thinking like that, that people from Soweto would move to Mexico. Never crossed my mind, you know. I mean, it was amazing, you know.
Yeah.
Amazing. Yeah. Amazing. Really something.
Yeah.
You are adventurous.
Yes, like you, Maharaj. Like you.
Yeah. But I appreciate that in you, maybe, because I'm also a bit adventurous. So, yeah, I like that. Yeah. And I like it that you are starting your education program. I think it's very nice. I wish you a lot of success. And I really hope it's going to take off big time.
Yeah.
Be wonderful.
Yeah, it's been a wonderful reception. Teaching yoga and meditation. I make the little ones, the five, they're like 3-year-olds, and my daughter joins in. And at the end, we all go like this, and we go, om, 6 times.
Yeah, you gradually connecting them, you know?
Yeah.
And one day from om comes, om namo bhagavate vasudevaya. Before you know it, you know. Yeah. Before you know it, they're chanting Hare Krishna and joining Rati Acha.
Yes.
The next time we have Soweto Rati Acha, we can maybe get the kids on stage, you know, if the parents want. But
yeah,
would be really nice if the kids are on stage and they all do om or whatever, some little yoga. That'd be super cool.
Yeah, that would be super cool. That would. Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be nice. Very nice.
And Maharaj, I'm getting prepared in September. I hope to be initiated.
Yes, that would be great. I'm very happy for that. You deserve it.
Oh.
No, definitely. Yeah, absolutely. You've been around, you know, not just since yesterday, but not for quite some time. So
yeah,
you know what you're getting into. You know, it's not like right that you just sort of do it all sentimental. You are actually, you know, been a devotee for a long time. So
yeah,
that's so it's good. Will be a good thing.
Yay.
Okay, I am about to disappear because I'm in this retreat and there's a hall full of devotees and I'm supposed to go there and say something about Bhakti Churu Maharaj's disappearance. So I thank you all for being with me. Each week the mood is a little different. This week it was entertaining, funny, and serious at the same time. So Krishna consciousness is like that. It is serious, and at the same time, there are so many things that we laugh about. It can be jolly, playful, natural, and that is actually so human, you know. So I like that. That we can be human and serious about Krishna consciousness at the same time. Thank you, and see you again next week, if not sooner, somewhere on some stream or in real life. I'm heading for Prague tomorrow, so and we'll be there for a while. So if you're not too far away, you can find me in Prague, Czech Republic. Always welcome. Just in the spur of the moment, just come over and we'll be happy to spend some time. Thank you. And otherwise, there's always the internet and we can see Prague on the internet. Sure, see you very soon, and thank you very much. Hare Krishna.